question.
Okay, so the last time we left off, we were here. We had looked at endochondral ossification, which, as I said, occurred in almost all bones of the body. And membranous or intramembranous ossification occurred in the cranial bones, especially the ones on the top of your skull and the clavicle. And here, let's look at the growth plate, which we saw here. It's also known as the epiphyseal plate or epiphyseal cartilage, this one here. This is what it looks like in an X-ray. So if you look at a child's hand up here, look at a child's hand and look at this translucent area. So these are the two parts of the radius. And this is the medial bone of the forearm, the ulna. So this is the epiphysis, this is the diaphysis, epiphysis, diaphysis. You can look up here too in these bones. Here's the epiphysis, diaphysis, diaphysis, epiphysis. And this area in between is not a fracture. This is actually the growth plate or epiphyseal cartilage. It continues to grow. It helps in growth. And then at around, you know, different age, by about 21 and 18 in female, 21 in male, most of your bones have fused. But they all fuse at different times. So once this fuses, can you see here that it's a complete bone? All of these are complete bones. You don't see any spaces in between. And this part, which is represented here by a line, this is known as the epiphyseal line. So this line here is called the epiphyseal line, and it represents the area between the epiphysis and the diaphysis where the growth plate has fused. So, you know, when people look at an X-ray, they can actually tell the age of the child, because all of these, you can see this is a much younger child because only about 4 of the carpal bones have come. Here you can see a much older child, a little bit few more of the carpal bones have come, so pediatricians can actually tell the age of the child. So now we did the ossification and we, you know, the two types, and we talked of the cells. You know, remember there were the osteoblasts which laid down the matrix, then they got caught in between and they formed osteocytes, and then you had osteoclasts, which was the ones which removed bone. Now, apart from this kind of ossification, throughout life, actually your bones constantly get remodeled. So there are areas where bone is deposited, there are areas where bone is removed. So that is known as deposition and resorption. And this is dependent quite often. And a good example to give you is that, you know, the more you stress your bone, and this is good stress. I mean, I don't say you stress it to break your bone, but whenever you do any exercise, you go on long walks or you play some game, you're putting some mechanical stress on the bone. So bone gets deposited in those areas, and where there is less stress, then bone gets removed. Okay. So even, for example, when you have a fracture, which we'll see in the next slide or so, the bone gets deposited. So first the fracture is very uneven, and then at some parts more bone is deposited, at other areas bone is removed. So you can see there's deposition and there's removal. The deposition is done by the osteoblast, the removal is done by osteoclast, and together they actually remodel the bone or make the bone look like what it is supposed to look like. So here is an example up here. So you can see this is the cartilage. So when growth is occurring, remember the epiphyseal cartilage helps growth in a vertical fashion, or what is known as interstitial growth. Then this overtakes, this bone deposition overtakes it, and the cartilage then fuses. And the only place the hyaline cartilage in a cartilage model doesn't ossify is where it forms articular cartilage. And here, so this was initially where all growth is occurring. So here you can see that now in the body, the bone, it realized that at this part, maybe a lot more bone was formed. I need to kind of remove bone from here, but I need to deposit it here. So you can see how remodeling occurs. So some bone is removed from here by osteoclasts, and at this point, bone is deposited on the outside. So here you can see remodeling going on. So when bone increases in length, we called it interstitial growth. Okay, and I was telling some of the students here, the way you can remember it is inter means in between. Anything inter means in between. And if you look at it, this epiphyseal cartilage is in between the epiphysis and the diaphysis. So it helps in growth interstitial. So it lies in between and it helps in interstitial growth. And we also have bone deposition on the outside, which is up here, which is known as appositional growth. So this is called appositional, which is, so bones can grow in thickness also. So interstitial growth will stop once this epiphyseal cartilage has fused. But the thickness of the bone can keep on happening as, you know, a person, throughout a person's life. And that's what mechanical stress does. It's your, after we have, you know, after our epiphyses have fused, when you kind of exercise and so on, you're stressing the bones. And this is good stress, as I explained, and that helps to deposit bones. So old people are always said, told to go and exercise so that, you know, they don't suffer from a condition called osteoporosis. And osteoporosis is a condition which you can see here. Osteoporosis is a condition where deposition and resorption are imbalanced. So the bone deposition is low, but resorption is more. So what happens? The bones become brittle. Right? But if you keep exercising and you work out and, you know, do however much you can, then because you're mechanically stressing the bone, bone will keep getting deposited, and that'll help you to at least overcome some of osteoporosis. Now, this deposition and resorption is dependent on mechanical stress, as I explained, also dependent on certain genetic factors. Some people, you know, have heavy bones in their family, some not so much. Hormonal factors, because you have hormones which are important in calcium metabolism, then the two hormones which play a prominent role are a hormone called parathormone and another hormone called calcitonin. So there are two hormones, parathormone and calcitonin. They do exactly the two opposite things. Calcitonin helps to deposit calcium in bones. It deposits calcium in bones. Parathormone removes calcium from bone. So why would you want to remove calcium? The idea is bone is not the only place where calcium is present. Actually, calcium only does not only reside in bones. Calcium is needed for neuromuscular transmission between nerve and muscle. So very, very muscle in the nervous system, in smooth muscle. But calcium, the body senses it. So what does it say? It says, I need more calcium in my blood. Where can I take it from? From the bones. So parathormone will be, the body will sense it, a gland called parathyroid gland will secrete parathormone and it will remove it into the body. On the hand, your body, right? Calcitonin is released and it takes calcium from the blood and pushes it into bone so that levels come to normal. Okay? Well, this in bones, it is used. Can you understand how it would find a use in osteoporosis, right? So you actually use a synthetic calcitonin in such people. We talked of vitamin D, and remember when we did the integumentary system, how actually vitamin D is the one which ties in the integumentary with the skeletal system. So it's very important because vitamin D is important for absorption of calcium from the GI tract and from the kidney tubules. It gets activated under the influence of sunlight. And if there is lack of calcium and vitamin D, then you get rickets, which is a condition where you can see this child here where the bones are extremely soft. Calcium is not deposited in the bone, so they're more cartilage-like, very soft, so they tend to bend. You have a lot of bony deformities, the epiphyseal plates thicken at that area. You can see this young child, you know, the arms are so long and calcium is not deposited. So epiphyseal cartilages continue to keep adding cartilage. So the bones get very long and thin. And here's a little video on this.
We're researchers estimate 1 billion people worldwide have inadequate levels of vitamin D in their blood.
The problem has gotten so bad in the United Kingdom that the childhood disease known as rickets, which causes bowed legs and curved spines, has reemerged. In today's Health Check, Elaine Cleveland shows us how to get the proper levels of vitamin D.
A dreary December day is a telltale sign that winter has once again reared its ugly head. And according to doctors, we produce vitamin D with help from the sun.
Build your bones.
Without it, there can be adverse health effects.
If you're not getting enough vitamin D, you don't absorb calcium, and you can increase your risk of rickets, osteopenia, or osteoporosis. And it also has been associated with depression, and that may be part of the winter blues.
The deficiency particularly affects the elderly and African Americans.
Do you have a vitamin D deficiency?
You don't know. We're going to find out.
That's one reason why doctors recommend those most at risk get a blood test to determine their levels.
Unless you're getting it at another source, you don't get any in the wintertime.
If your vitamin D levels are considered low, something as simple as a tweak in diet can make up for the deficiency. Doctors say foods such as salmon and mackerel are rich in vitamin D, and other foods such as tuna canned in water, sardines canned in oil, and dairy products such as egg yolks and milk all contain vitamin D.
The best source is dairy products, because vitamin D is added by law to most dairy products.
If dairy and fish don't sound appealing,
vitamin D is available in any retail store.
Dr. Welders recommends people take a daily supplement.
And this is the usual, most common strength, there's 1,000.
Because in the winter, the sun certainly won't help.
In the wintertime, it doesn't matter because the sun is so weak that even being out in the sun skiing all day, you're still not going to get very much vitamin D.
The doctors say that in the summer, you need 15 minutes of sunlight a day to absorb the necessary vitamin D levels.
Yes. It is at the maximum. Oh, okay, no. Okay, let's look at this question. Why is this growth plate important? Very good. It allows the bone to grow in length. See, intramembranous ossification, this was in membrane. Remember, there was no epiphyseal plate. Epiphyseal plate is hyaline cartilage. Intramembranous ossification, it was membranous tissue which changed into bone. So there was no cartilage there, okay? So in a person whose epiphysis has fused, what type of bone growth is possible? Appositional growth, yes, that's correct, very good, yes. There is going to be growth. Remember, appositional growth is growth on the outside in thickness. That's going to occur throughout life. I told you, right, when you have mechanical stress, you're going to lay down bone on the outside. Interstitial growth is only occurring where as long as the epiphyseal plate is present. If the epiphyseal plate has fused, you cannot now grow in length. I mean, think of you. After 22, you do not grow in height at all, right? Or 20, you know, some boys might be till about 23. But beyond that, you don't grow in height. But you can get bulkier as far as your bones are concerned. And if you play a lot of games and you stress yourself out as far as good bone stress is, then bones will become thicker. In fact, the pituitary gland produces the growth hormone, which is responsible for musculoskeletal growth. And this is important. This musculoskeletal growth is important during childhood. So you need this growth hormone. In some people, when there is too much growth hormone produced when they are children, before their epiphyseal plates have fused, they can be really, really tall. And, you know, you have people who are over 8 feet tall, and such a condition is known as gigantism. Because epiphyseal plates have not fused, so the person keeps on growing. In contrast to that, there's another condition which is known as acromegaly, where here too, you don't have to write these down, I'm just telling you out of interest. In acromegaly, which occurs where, again, there's excess of growth hormone, but here the person's epiphyses have fused. And so they cannot grow in height, so they know, you know, their height is whatever it is, so they are that tall. But what happens is that if they can, the appositional growth is possible. So if you actually look at their fingers, if to begin with their fingers were about that, the bones of their fingers were about that thin, in these people you will find that their fingers begin to look much thicker because the bones have increased in thickness. Their jaw increases, the mandible becomes really, really thick. So they have a very, very prominent jawline which kind of tends to stick out. Other bones also get very thick there, and because the growth hormone does other things, they have other problems as well. So this is one place where you can see there is appositional growth here. Yes, dwarfism is the opposite of gigantism. It is when the growth hormone is production is much less than normal. So these people do not grow very tall. So they're really tiny. Yes, it's called pituitary dwarfism. So let's look at fractures and bone repair and see the importance of periosteum. So I'm sure some of you may have fractured a bone, or you definitely know someone who has fractured a bone at some point in their life. So what happens is initially when a bone fractures, and there are different types of fractures, so we won't go into that. We just look at a very simple fracture which hasn't displaced. So if here is a bone which has fractured, so at the area where it's fractured, because bone is very, very vascular, the blood vessels get torn. So the blood collects in the space between the two fractured fragments. So this collection of blood is known as a hematoma. So this is called the hematoma. And so this hematoma is there, present in between the two fractured ends. And, you know, it kind of helps to seal the two ends together, if only for a temporary period. Then the periosteum, remember the periosteum has what are known as osteogenic cells. So the periosteum has osteogenic cells. These osteogenic cells are the stem cells which can give rise to osteoblasts and osteoclasts. So this osteogenic cells, they give rise to, along with fibroblasts, because the periosteum has fibrous tissue also. So the fibroblasts as well as these osteogenic cells, they begin to lay down cartilage up here. And they kind of, and fibrous tissue. So this area, the blood kind of is removed by macrophages. And up here, you get a sort of fibrocartilaginous callus, which is formed. So this callus is soft, and it keeps the two ends together. Attracts blood vessels. So it's kind of an ossification, which is occurring at this point. It attracts blood vessels. The blood brings calcium, and calcium gets deposited there. So now from a fibrocartilaginous soft callus, a bony callus is formed. But here again, the bone is still, you know, it's kind of in an irregular form. So now the osteoclasts will come and they will remove bone from the parts where it's not needed so that you get a smooth line, and then you finally get, the bone becomes a proper shape. So you can see how it's remodeled to look like what it should look like, right? So you have an initial hematoma, then first a fibrocartilaginous callus. Callus is like scar tissue, which is formed. That becomes bony, and then the osteoclasts remove the excess bone so that the line is smooth. And so this is what happens in fractures and how the bone is repaired. So you can see how periosteum is really important for regeneration and growth. And here let's look at a fracture.
The fracture of a bone is usually caused by direct violence or by a strong twisting strain. When a bone fractures, the two fragments separate and in so doing tear the arteries in the Habesham systems across the fracture line. This damage results in the leakage of blood into the fracture, where it is trapped and soon clots. After a short time, the Habershan arteries go into spasm, causing the death of active bone cells not only at the fracture site, but also for some distance along the shaft. About 2 days after the break, the blood clot is invaded by capillaries and fibroblasts. The fibroblasts differentiate into bone-forming cells, or osteoblasts, and cells that form periosteal tissue on the outside of the bone. New tissue, called callus, surrounds the fracture and replaces the dead bone. The dead bone is absorbed and replaced by new bone, formed by osteoblasts in the callus, which is remodeled by cells called osteoclasts to its original shape. This remodeling process is so effective that after a few months, it is difficult to detect the fracture site.
Sometimes when you take an x-ray a few months after the fracture has occurred, you may not even see the fracture line. Sometimes you might, but not always.
Is it the osteoblasts?
Osteoblasts are the ones which lay down the matrix. Remember, clasts are the ones which remove bone. Together, they help to remodel. So now we are going to look at the actual skeleton. So I want you to look at this picture really well. Keep looking at it so that you know which bones articulate with which bones. In other words, which bones are in contact with which bones, which joints are formed. For example, if you look here, the humerus articulates above with the scapula to form the shoulder. Below it articulates with the radius and ulna to form the elbow joint. So it's a good idea to look at this frequently, okay? Now the rest of the slides that we are going to be doing from here on, I want you to be looking at the slides real carefully. Look at all the information that is given on the slide. Always know what which side, if there are bones, which there are two bones, for example, in the forearm and the leg, which bone is the medial, which bone is the lateral. Look at certain terms which are boxed in your notes. You know, you have terms like trochanters, tuberosities, condyles, epicondyles. So this is where you're actually going to look at them. So, you know, you should know which bones have these. So looking at these pictures really frequently is where it's going to help you, okay? So let's start with fontanelles. Let's start with the skull. And in the skull, in a fetal skull, and as soon as the child is born, the skull has not ossified completely. You actually have areas where, remember, the skull bone, especially the top of the skull, this area of the skull here, it's called the skull cap. This, the bones are not completely ossified. They are actually joined together by membrane, so that membrane is still to ossify. And areas where those membranes are present, those areas are known as fontanelles, or these are what you call soft spot in a child, in a baby. This is what you call the soft spot. The one that you most frequently feel is this anterior fontanelle, which is right on the top here between the frontal bones and the parietal bones. So this is the frontal and the parietal bones. But you have fontanelles, as you can see, you have fontanelles on the side, and then you have a fontanelle at the back also. So these fontanelles are important because, first of all, the first thing they help to do is that as the child is being born through the birth canal, these fontanelles actually help do something known as molding. They help the cranial bones slide over one another. So molding is helping the cranial bones to slide over one another. And this happens during birth. So because the fetal head has to pass through the pelvic cavity, what happens is that the bones, because there is this soft membranous tissue in between and the bones have not fused as yet, so you can understand this bone can go over this bone, slide over, this can go over the other one. So can you see that the diameter of the skull can become smaller so the baby passes easily through? So this is known as molding, okay? Yes.
Is that the same as like a baby born with a cone head?
This is what happens when a child, when molding occurs, and if the child is in, if the mother is in labor for a very long time, obviously it can cause a little bit of damage. So under the skin of the, and over the skull, but under the skin, little blood can collect because blood vessels can, you know, sort of bleed. So you can get little hematomas which can lead to cone heads, or the skull bones will not fracture or anything. They'll come back. That's cone heads and other misshapen heads that you get quite often are due to little hematomas that will form there. Okay. Then once a child is... Well, yes.
So naturally it's not supposed to damage the brain.
It is not supposed to damage because it's not as if one bone slides over the other so much that it's totally squished. It's just a gentle sliding without damaging the brain inside. You get this? Just so that the diameter gets becomes a little less than what it is. And that's why cesarean babies tend to have perfect heads because they have no molding. These children who come out for some time, who come out through the natural birth passages, you might find the skull is a bit misshapen, but it comes back to its normal shape. And that's why, because these bones are so soft, so we often tell parents not to, to make sure that the child doesn't lie on one side only. Because when the children, babies sleep, if they lie only on one side, that side can get flattened. And then you have other problems, you know. So we won't go into that. But you have other, that's a whole new topic by itself, okay? The other thing, once the child is born, these fontanelles don't fuse immediately after the child is born. They take time. So by about from 6 to 18 months is when the fusion occurs. So they get converted to bone. So, you know, this gets converted to bone all over from 6 to 18 months. So there must be a reason why it is still present. And that is because the baby's skull has to grow to accommodate the growing brain. So it this helps in both skull growth as well as brain growth. So that's the these are the three functions of the fontanelles: to allow molding during labor, to allow skull growth, and hence also to help with brain growth. Now, we make use of the fact that these fontanelles are present for a long time, you know, till about 6 months. The anterior fontanelle, usually by about 6 to 8 months, it fuses. We make use of this fact that we can feel this soft spot. So in children, when children get dehydrated, what happens is the inside the skull, there is something known as cerebrospinal fluid. It's a fluid which kind of bathes the brain. So when a child is dehydrated, even the cerebrospinal fluid will be less. So what happens is the fontanelle becomes depressed here. So, you know, instead of being at level with the skull, you'll find a dip in the fontanelle. And pediatricians will often, as a quick diagnosis, will just touch the soft spot to see if it's depressed, then they can immediately tell that the child is dehydrated while they carry out other tests. The opposite, if, for example, the child is suffering from some kind of nervous problem like meningitis, where the intracranial pressure rises, so the cerebrospinal fluid actually increases, what happens? There's more fluid, it'll cause a bulge in the fontanelle. So by feeling this soft spot, they can actually feel the bulge and they know that the intracranial pressure has risen. So this is one thing that the physician kind of uses. But this is not a function of the fontanelle to tell tell you whether it's dehydrated or whether a child is overhydrated or has raised intracranial tension. We just use it for that, okay? But function is only these three: molding, skull growth, and brain growth. So now from that, we come to the adult skull. So you're going to do more of the skeletal system in the lab. So I won't do individual bones, but certain areas, wherever in the PowerPoint you find important things written, you have to know these. So here, for example, you can see that this part on top is known as the cranial vault. And this area here is called the base of the skull. So this whole thing here is the skull, okay? And this is the facial skeleton. The skull is made up over here, this part, the skull. This part has a vault and this part has a base. So there are 8 of these cranial bones over here. And some of them you should know. This is frontal, this is parietal, this is temporal. This one here is called the occipital, and there are sutures in between them, which you do in the lab. And there are 14 facial bones. Some important ones you should know are, for example, this one is called the mandible. And this one here is called the maxilla, and a few others you do in the lab. And then this picture here is actually showing you, so if I sort of took a saw and took off this cranial vault, or what is also known as the skull cap, and then I was peeping inside, this is what I would see, right? I'm looking into the interior of the skull, and this is where the brain is going to lie. So, you know, you have the cerebral hemispheres like this, one on either side. And then the cerebral hemispheres continue into what is known as the brain stem, and a part of the brain stem passes out through here. It passes out and it continues into the spinal cord. So if you look at it like this, this is the brain and the spinal cord. So this part is what is present in the skull, and this spinal cord is what is present in the vertebral canal. So this medulla continues as the spinal cord, and it passes out through this big hole, which is known as the foramen magnum. So along with this medulla, you have some blood vessels also which pass through. So this is one thing that you should know. What passes through the foramen magnum? The lower end of the medulla with some blood vessels. Then when you look at these bones of the skull and the face, there are certain bones which have little air spaces inside them. Those air spaces are known as paranasal sinuses. Para means by the side of the nose, and sinus is really a space. You will find veins also, when they're extremely dilated, we call it a sinus. So sinus is really something dilated or a space. So these lie by the side of the nose, so they are known as paranasal sinuses. So you have four of them. So the frontal bone has one. Sometimes they are fused, or sometimes there may be two of these frontal sinuses. You have ethmoidal, are not a single sinus. They are few, three, four cells together. So that's why they often call ethmoidal air cells. And then we have a sinus in the sphenoid bone and one in the maxilla. The maxillary is the largest. So I don't know, you can make up something. FEMS is what comes to mind. Okay. So what is the function of these paranasal sinuses? Now, they're present along the side of the nose. They all drain into the nasal cavity. So they have little ducts which help them to open into the nasal cavity. And the nasal mucosa actually goes in and lines these sinuses. So whatever is the function of the nose, these sinuses also help. So first is, it helps to warm and humidify the air. So it helps you to warm and humidify the air. It also helps to add resonance to your voice. You know, whenever your sinuses are filled, you all must have noticed that your voice sounds different, right? So it gives you that little resonance to your voice. And it also helps to lighten the skull. But light, it's not that it makes the skull absolutely sort of floating light, but just helps to lighten a little bit. The more important features are to humidify and warm the air, add resonance to the voice, and then lighten the skull. So these are the functions. So you must know which bones have the paranasal sinuses, what are the functions of the paranasal sinuses. Then let's look at the vertebral column. So this consists of 33 vertebrae. And when you're looking at it in front, from here, you cannot tell. The vertebral column is meant to be absolutely straight. In fact, when it is curved in either on sideways or front to back, you actually have a condition. That's a vertebral deformity called kyphosis or scoliosis. Now, when you're looking at the vertebral column from the side, and this part is anterior and this part is posterior, can you notice that the vertebral column is kind of curved? It's here, when you're looking at it from the front, you can't see. But when you see it from the side, can you see that in this cervical region, it is curved anteriorly? In the thoracic region, it is curved this way. There's a concave curve. Here, it's convex. So this is cervical. This is thoracic. In the lumbar region, can you see again there is a curvature, convex curvature? And then when you come to the sacral again, can you see there's a concave curvature? Can you see that, right? So of these curvatures, we have two which are present before birth. They are known as primary curvatures. They are present before birth. And there are two which are present after birth, and it's because of something that we do that these curvatures develop, and these are secondary, so they are after birth. Normally, when you look at it, actually the vertebral column is, to begin with, when a child is born, the vertebral column is actually concave all through. Can you see? The vertebral column is really concave. If this is anterior and this side is posterior, the vertebral column is really concave all the way through. So which of these two curvatures are concave, remain concave? Sacral, right. Thoracic and sacral. So these are the ones which are primary curvatures because they remain that same way. The thoracic and sacral, these are primary curvatures and they are present before birth and they remain that way. When the child is born and then it begins to lift its head, so what happens? It lifts its head, right? So then the cervical curvature forms. So here, can you see? Now it becomes convex. So this part now becomes convex. So the cervical curvature is the first of the secondary curvature to form after birth when the child begins to hold its head, which is why till about 3 months you always have to hold the child very, very carefully by the head because it's not able to balance. So it keeps kind of bobbing up and down, right? You have to support it. And then from anywhere after 6 months when the child begins to stand, now it puts pressure on the lumbar region. So then the lumbar spinal curvature forms. So here, this one here becomes convex. Can you see that? So the ones which appear after birth are the cervical and the lumbar. Cervical because it holds its head, lumbar because it stands up. So that puts pressure and then that becomes, so then you finally have like this. Okay? So cervical and lumbar and thoracic and sacral. Do you see that? So that's, those are curvatures. Primary before birth, secondary after birth. Now the vertebrae. So we have 33 vertebrae and we divide them according to these numbers. So I just heard a really good way and I added a little bit on my own. So let's see how to remember how many vertebrae, which area has which. So cervical, first of all, you know cervical, the neck is called the cervical region. Then you have thoracic, then you have lumbar, and then you have sacral and coccygeal. So let's say we have grandma has breakfast at 7. She has lunch at 12. So this is cervical. So lunch is the next one, which is thoracic. And she has dinner at 5, rather early, but she has dinner at 5. And she never forgets to take her 5 servings of fruits and 4 of vegetables. Or you can change it, 5 of vegetables and 4 of fruits. So that's the way you're going to remember, okay? The difference being in this is that the cervical, thoracic and lumbar are all separate vertebrae. In the sacral region and the coccyx, these 5 are fused to form one bone, sacrum, but it's really made up of 5 vertebrae. And coccyx is made up of 4 coccygeal vertebrae, but when you see it, it's kind of one bone. Okay, but so we still count them, so we say we have 33 vertebrae. Now, the way you're going to remember which one has, what are the prominent features? They all have some common features, but what is so distinguishing about some of them? Cervical vertebrae have something known as a transverse foramen or also called foramen transversarium. And we'll see that. In the transverse process, there's a foramen or a hole. The thoracic vertebrae, they are present in the region of the thorax where your ribs are. So they have smooth surfaces which are known as facets to articulate with the ribs. Anything to do with rib is known as costal. So they have costal facets. Facet is a smooth articular surface. So they have costal facets on the body and transverse process, which I'll show you. So wherever you have costal facets, that is a thoracic vertebra. The lumbar is identified by the process of elimination. Notice I have nothing special for lumbar. It does not have a transverse foramen. It does not have costal facets. Then you call it a lumbar. Sacrum and coccyx, obviously, it's easy to find. Look at those, okay? So let's look at vertebrae, and first let's look at some common features of all vertebrae. First thing, the front of a vertebra, this area here is known as the vertebral body or also called the centrum. So this part is called the centrum. Then at the back you have a little thing that sticks out, it looks like a spine. This is the spinous process, which is present posteriorly. on either side, like two limbs sticking out. They stick out transversely because they're horizontal. These are known as transverse processes. Here, this is a transverse process. Connecting the body to this rest of the vertebra, which is the transverse and the spinous processes, is this part, this kind of little bridge of bone, which is known as the pedicle. It connects the body to the part behind, which is the transverse and the spinous processes. And on either side of the spinous process, you can see this area of bone. On either side of the spinous process, this area of bone is known as the lamina. So you really don't have to write anything. All you have to do is look at the picture. So if you look at it, the pedicle connects here. The pedicle is connecting the body to the rest of the vertebra behind it. Where does the lamina lie? On either side of the spinous process, or between the spinous process and the transverse process. Can you see? This part is the lamina. Now, each vertebra articulates with the one above and the one below, right? So you have little processes where it's able to articulate with the vertebra above and below. So these are known as superior, and you can't see the inferior because it's below. These are called superior and inferior articular facets, okay? That process, this part is called the process. This facet is just a smooth area. So make sure you go look in the lab and look at these parts. Now, all of these parts, they enclose a huge opening. That opening is known as the vertebral foramen, or also called the spinal foramen. And the way you will, it's better to remember it as the spinal foramen or vertebral foramen. And it's called spinal because the spinal cord passes through. And when you do the nervous system, you will see that the spinal cord does not end right up to the coccyx. It does not go all the way down to the coccyx. It actually ends at the lumbar region. From there on, there is no spinal cord, but there's actually a sheaf of nerve fibers. And that's why I've written that. It's called, that sheaf of nerve fibers is called cauda equina. It looks like a horse's tail. So that, so spinal cord continues, you can say, as cauda equina. So either it's the spinal cord in the, till the lumbar region, and from there onwards, it is the cauda equina which is present. No. They do have the sheaf. Spina bifida is a condition when this spinous process is bifid. It's not formed properly. So imagine if the spine has not fused, so you can see like this, the lamina, the spine has not formed, so this is not there at all. Can you see that the bone is now opened here? And so now your spinal cord can actually bulge out, okay? That, and there are different degrees of spina bifida. Okay. Let's look at some atypical vertebrae, and the two that are important are this, the cervical vertebrae, and here you can see this is a huge vertebral foramen in both up here. And in the cervical vertebrae, if you remember from the previous slide, they have something called the transverse foramen. So only in the cervical, there is a hole here in the transverse process. So the transverse process actually kind of encloses a little hole like that, which you can see here. See this? That's why it's called transverse foramen. So you have three foramen, two transverse and one vertebral. The first cervical vertebra is known as the atlas. It's called atlas after the Greek god who actually held the entire universe on his shoulders. And the atlas is actually, it articulates with the occipital bone and it holds the skull. That's why it's got the name atlas. It holds the skull up. If you notice, the atlas is like a ring-shaped vertebra because there is no body. So it's the first cervical, or C1. There is no body in the atlas. It also doesn't have a spinous process. Can you see? No spinous process. It just has a little tubercle there. So these are, and it's a ring-shaped vertebra, the first cervical. The second cervical vertebra is known as the axis. So don't confuse the names. The axis is the second cervical vertebra. And what it has is, it has its body. So it has a small body like this. But sitting on top of the body actually is a process. And that process here is called the dens. it actually, this dent represents the body of the first. It's almost as if the body of the first broke off and went and stuck on the second cervical vertebra, okay? So it has a little pointed, it has something extra. This has something missing, this has something extra. That means on the body you have actually, you can't see the body because this thing is sitting on top of the body, this little projection called the dents. And otherwise it still has the transverse foramen. You can't see it in this picture, but there's a transverse foramen on either side. So it's otherwise typical like a cervical vertebra. So here let's look at these vertebrae and see how we can differentiate them. So cervical vertebra, most distinguishing feature is the presence of the transverse process. And then some other thing is that the spinous process here, you can see it, instead of being single, it's kind of bifid. Can you see it's kind of flared out like that? The thoracic vertebra, because this is the one which articulates with the ribs. So the ribs actually will be articulating here at the body and then they go to the transverse process and that's how they will come on either side. So the ribs articulate with the sternum in front and the vertebra behind. They'll go this way and come like this. So from the front, you can't see this facet well, but you can see a little bit. But if you look at it from the side, can you see that you have a facet here on the body above and below and on the transverse process? You have these smooth surfaces which are known as costal facets for the rib. See over here, you don't have anything here. You don't have anything here. You don't have anything here. But here you can see that on the thoracic vertebra only, you have costal facets on the body as well as transverse process. So that's how a thoracic vertebra is identified. Look at a lumbar vertebra, no foramen transversarium, no costal facets either on the body or the transverse process, so hence it's lumbar. And then it also so happens, if you take it from the same person, a lumbar vertebra is much larger than the other two. It also, the spinous, the transverse processes are very thin, so notice they are much thinner than the others. And if you look at the spinous process from the side, can you see the spinous process is kind of more like a rectangle instead of being pointed? Can you see these are kind of a little bit more pointed here? But this is more like a rectangle. But those are other features. But the main thing is you always identify a lumbar vertebrae by process of elimination. Okay? Now this is showing you vertebrae which are articulating together, see, one over the other. So that's why you needed those superior and inferior articular facets. So here's one vertebra sitting on top of the other. And what happens is when each vertebral foramen lines up, one vertebral foramen is lining up over the next, that whole thing becomes a canal. So when vertebral foramen are lined up, you get a vertebral canal, which is all the way down. And when these vertebrae articulate with one another, you have little spaces in between them, which you can see here, which is known as the intervertebral foramen. And each vertebra is actually separated by a disc, which is known as the intervertebral disc, which is fibrocartilage in nature. And this disc is what, you know, when you've heard of people who have a herniated disc and so on, this is what, this disc is the one which actually bulges. So most of the time it tends to kind of bulge out at the back like that. So it'll bulge out and push on the nerve or the spinal cord. So looking at this picture, you had a question?
Right where you have your red mark, that's the fibrocartilage?
This here is the fibrocartilage which is covered by connective tissue. So looking at this picture, that's why I want you to look at the images real carefully, and now you answer the next question. What passes through the vertebral foramen? And this you had even previously. Very good, yes. It is the spinal cord which passes through. Look at this here. The spinal cord. Remember, this is the vertebral foramen in one vertebra. It passes through this. It'll go through the next, right in the center. When the vertebral foramen are lined up, that forms the canal. in the intervertebral foramen are these. This is where you have the spinal nerves and blood vessels, okay? So the cord is in the center and it sends out these nerves and blood vessels on either side. The nerves come out from the cord, the blood vessels are separate. Now here there's nothing much about the sacrum and the coccyx, 5 sacral vertebra, 4 coccygeal. If you look at it in front, these you had those intervertebral foramina here. These are known as sacral foramina. You have seen them in the front and the back. And this sharp edge of the sacrum here is known as the sacral promontory. And again, between the sacrum and coccyx also you have a joint called the sacrococcygeal joint. Then we come to the ribs and the sternum. So here again, if you look at the whole thoracic cage, so this whole cage consists of the sternum in front, the ribs on the sides, and the ribs, you can see, they articulate with the sternum directly or indirectly, and posteriorly they articulate with the vertebral column. So let's look at first the sternum. It has 3 parts and they are separated by joints. So there's a joint here and a joint here. The top is called the manubrium, the middle is called the body, and the lower part is called the xiphoid process. So between the manubrium and the body, this part here where it says sternal angle, that is a part which we can all feel on ourselves actually. That is known as the manubriosternal joint. Between the manubrium and the body of the sternum. And then here between the xiphoid and the body of the sternum, this part is called the xiphisternal joint. So when we do joints, we'll be talking about these. And here, just from this picture, you can see that the sternum is articulating with these costal cartilages, which are hyaline. And these costal cartilages, in turn, are then continue as the ribs. Now, we have 12 pairs of ribs. The first 7 are called true ribs. These are called true ribs because they articulate with the vertebra posteriorly. And they articulate directly with the sternum. So you can see how they're articulating through their costal cartilage. They are articulating directly with the sternum. So the first 7 pairs are called true ribs. False ribs, they articulate with vertebra posteriorly, but they articulate indirectly with the sternum. Indirectly with sternum. What do I mean by indirectly? What they do is that each of these, look at this, they are 8th, 9th, and 10th. Sorry, this false should say 8th to 10th. Okay, this is 8th to 10th. If you look at it, the 8th, the 10th, its costal cartilage articulates with the 9th. The costal cartilage of the 9th articulates with the 8th. The 8th then goes to the 7th, and then through the 7th it reaches the sternum. So it's not going directly to the sternum, okay? The last 2 ribs are known as floating ribs because they only articulate with the vertebra. They have no sternal attachment. So they're only with the vertebra. You can see this one and this one. Only with the vertebra. Okay, so you can see all of these ribs articulate with the vertebrae. First 7 with the sternum directly, the next 3 sternum indirectly. Now, ribs are only present in the thoracic region, but sometimes when the baby is, the fetus is developing, ribs actually develop all over the body, cervical and lumbar region also, but they just disappear. Sometimes you might have a condition where a cervical rib is formed. So if this is the C7 vertebra, so you might have a rib which is present here. And often what happens is that it's not supposed to be there, and we have major blood vessels and nerves which pass out from the thorax into the upper limb. So they can be compressed by the cervical nerve, cervical rib, and the person can have tingling sensation and numbness and all in the upper limb. Sometimes it may cause no problem and it's only accidentally discovered on an X-ray. Okay? Then when we come to the limbs, now you should know girdles. So here, the pectoral girdle is a girdle. It's like a C-shaped girdle, which is formed between the clavicle and the scapula. So on either side, it's between the clavicle up here in front and the scapula. So the scapula goes all the way back like that. So it's a C shape on either side. So here, that's the pectoral of this side and the pectoral of that side. So it's formed by clavicle and scapula. And in fact, the clavicle is really important because the scapula does not articulate with the vertebra, with the axial skeleton. It only articulates here with the humerus, and here it articulates with the clavicle. So what happens is that when your weight of your limb is actually transmitted from your fingers, it goes all the way up to your shoulder joint, and it, from here it goes to the scapula. But if the scapula was not articulating with the clavicle, there's no way for this weight to go to the axial skeleton, because the scapula doesn't articulate with the axial skeleton at all. But because of this fact that it is articulating with the clavicle, the weight from here, from the humerus, goes into the scapula. Through here, it goes into the clavicle. The clavicle goes to the sternum, and that's how the weight comes. So from the sternum, then it'll go all the way around to the ribs and to the back and then come down. Okay, this is just for interest's sake to tell you what an important bone the clavicle is, which is why you find when people have a fracture of the clavicle like this, the limb droops because the weight is no longer being able to be transmitted across. So here, important things that you can see. This is showing you the clavicle. Its medial end articulates with the sternum, laterally with the scapula. So you must know which bones, the bones mentioned here, articulate with. So the clavicle, and that's why always put your finger there. So in the medial end, the clavicle articulates with the sternum at the sternoclavicular joint. Laterally, it articulates with the scapula, the acromion of the scapula, which is called the acromioclavicular joint, okay? Then when you look at the scapula, it articulates with the clavicle and it articulates with the humerus. And there are certain important parts here. So this part here is the glenoid cavity. It's a little cavity with where the it articulates with the humerus. So this is where it articulates with the humerus. And here, this end is called the acromial end, which is where it articulates with the clavicle. The rest of the stuff you will do in the lab. Then when we come to humerus, everything that you really need to know is given here. So, you know, I don't want you to know too many things. One thing that you need to know is that it is the bone of the arm. It's a single bone, I mean one on each arm. It forms the shoulder joint with the scapula. So above it articulates with the scapula. And below it articulates with the radius and ulna to form the elbow joint. Okay, that's why looking at the skeleton is so important. And then in your description, in your notes, remember we talked of things called tubercles and trochanters and so on. So you can see that in the humerus, we talk of something called a tubercle, or also known as a tuberosity. Tubercle or tuberosity. This is just a elevation, a projection. And then this rounded area looks like a head. So this is called the head of the humerus. This narrow area is constricted, so this is called the neck of the humerus. It's often called the anatomical neck. And then there's another further constriction here where this part, the upper end or epiphysis, joins with the diaphysis. This area is called surgical neck. The reason it's called surgical neck is because you have some important blood vessels and nerves which are present here. So if this part was to fracture, you would probably have to do some surgery in order to make sure that those nerves and blood vessels are taken care of. That's why that area is called surgical neck of the humerus. Okay? At the lower end of the humerus, notice you have again a rounded ball-like structure. Capitulum is where there is a smooth rounded area. And the word trochlea means looks like a pulley. So you can see this looks a little bit like a pulley. So that's why it's called trochlea. So in the humerus, you have tubercles, you have the anatomical and surgical neck, trochlea, and there are some important nerves and blood vessels which are related. You don't need to know them right now. When we do some of the other, when we go to the nervous system. We'll talk more about these, okay? So which is why many nerves, and one important nerve, of course, I should tell you, is that, you know, you've all heard of the funny bone, right? So the entire humerus is not the funny bone. People always say the humerus is the funny bone. It's actually this part of the humerus here, which is known as the medial epicondyle. This area here called the medial epicondyle. That's called the funny bone because you can see there is a nerve related there. That nerve is called the ulnar nerve. And if you ever hit your medial, this edge of your medial epicondyle against a sharp surface, you get that little jarring feeling. And that's why it's called funny. The sensation is anything but funny. It's a really odd sensation. Then when we look at the forearm bones, so you have radius and ulna, you should know which bone is lateral, which bone is medial. Both of these bones articulate above with the humerus to form the elbow joint. And only the radius, so only the radius articulates with the carpal bones to form the wrist. The ulna does not take part in the wrist joint. So that's a really important thing to remember. You can see they are held together by connective tissue. Since it's between two bones, this is known as the interosseous membrane. Interosseous between two bones. And again, if you look at the radius, you've got a part of the radius, which is called the head, and just below it, a narrow constriction that's called the neck. Wherever you have a constriction, that's often called the neck. And both radius and ulna, at their lower ends, have something known as the styloid process. So they have something which is called the styloid process. It's a process which looks like a little sort of beak or a little pulled out process like that. So here you can see this is the styloid process of the radius. This little thing here is the styloid process of the ulna. And notice how the two bones kind of articulate with one another. So that's why we have the radio-ulnar joints between them. This is called proximal and distal radio-ulnar joints. Okay, so the radius and the ulna not only form elbow joint, the radius also forms the wrist joint, but they also form the radio-ulnar joints because they articulate with one another too. When you look at the hand, bones of the hand, this is what you need to know. There are 8 carpal bones, 5 metacarpals, 14 phalanges. You have 5 digits, but why 14? Because the thumb has only 2 phalanges, whereas all the others have 3 phalanges. That's why you have 14. And notice how only the radius is forming the wrist joint. See, the ulna is left out because there it doesn't participate in the wrist joint here. You don't need to know the individual names of these carpal bones, but you can see 8, 5 metacarpals, 14 phalanges.
So those are
eight carpal bones. 8 carpal bones, yes. Yeah. Then when we go to the lower limb, again, there's a common plan. So in the thigh, you have one bone. In the leg, you have 2 bones. The leg is like the forearm. You have a medial and a lateral one. So we'll begin with the girdle. So the pelvic girdle is, just as pectoral girdle was clavicle and scapula, the pelvic girdle is like a ring, an incomplete ring. So it's just the 2 hip bones. Just the 2 hip bones form the pelvic girdle. When you put the sacrum in between over here, then we call it the pelvis. Okay, so when the sacrum is added, then it's known as the bony pelvis. But the girdle is just the 2 hip bones. And each hip bone has 3 main parts to it. This part is called the ilium. This area is called the ischium. This part here is called the pubis. All of these actually meet in this little fossa, which is called the acetabular fossa. So they meet there. The acetabular fossa is just like the glenoid fossa of the scapula. Remember, the scapula articulated with the humerus to form the shoulder joint? Similarly, this hip bone will articulate with the femur to form the hip joint. So here's the femur. So this acetabulum is where the head of the femur will be. So hip joint and shoulder joint, very similar. So here is the bony pelvis. So you can see it is this 2 hip bones with the sacrum in between. And And between males and females, there are certain common, certain differences which tell you whether it's a male or female. It's not necessary that every feature has to be present in every male or every female, but this is most often what is present. So the pelvis is the hip bones and sacrum. In a female pelvis, this arch which is present below the pubis, this is called the pubic arch. You can see it is much wider. In the male, can you see it is much narrower? It's more acute. Notice this. Acute. And look at this. Obtuse. Like this. So the pubic arch is obtuse in females, acute in males. This is one very, very distinguishing feature between the male and female pelvis. Second, in males, what happens is that these iliac fossa, this part here, the iliac fossa is very deep. And what this does is it makes these two points of the bone, these two points are known as the anterior superior iliac spine, it makes these two points come close to each other, which is why men tend to have narrower hips. In women, these two points are flared out. They are further apart, so it makes this iliac fossa shallow. Okay, so that's why women have wider hips. So instead of being close together like this, women are like this. Wider hips, males, it's close together, so the fossa is deep. They have some more information in your notes, so you can take a look at that. But these are some really important ones which we use to find out the difference between them. And the other thing is because men have bigger muscles, so the markings are more prominent in males, and also up here because the penile tissue is attached here. So you will find that the markings in the male pelvis are much more well marked compared to a female pelvis. Smaller muscles, not so much genital tissue here, so not as marked. Now when we look at the femur, very, very similar to the humerus with a few differences. Again, you have a head which articulates with the acetabular fossa to form the hip joint. And then the knee, it forms the knee joint with the patella and the tibia. So it has a head, it has a neck, and instead of tubercles, we have larger projection. So these are known as trochanters. So you don't call them tubercles, you call them trochanters. Remember you had greater and lesser tubercle in the humerus. Here you have trochanters. And at the lower end, you have these articular surfaces which are known as condyles. So you have a lateral condyle and a medial condyle. So condyles are large, smooth articular surfaces. And anything which is above a condyle, epi means above. So this is known as the epicondyle. So you can see it has trochanters and condyles and epicondyles. The patella is what is called the kneecap. It's a sesamoid bone. What was important about sesamoid bone? These bones, yes, they don't have periosteum. So remember, all bones don't have periosteum because all bones don't have periosteum because sesamoid bones lack periosteum, okay? Then when we come to the bones of the leg, again, if you look at the radius and ulna, the radius was smaller, the ulna was a larger. Here again, and the larger one was medial, the ulna. So here also you have a large and a small bone. So the tibia is the medial bone, the fibula is the lateral bone. This is smaller, this is larger. Again, look at them attached by the interosseous membrane. And if you remember, I said in the forearm, the ulna took part in the elbow joint. So we said that the ulna formed the elbow joint. It formed the radio-ulnar joint, but it did not participate in the wrist joint. So now in the leg, you will find that the fibula, which is the narrower bone, it forms the ankle joint. So this is for the fibula. It forms the ankle joint. It forms the tibio-fibular joints, but it doesn't form the knee joint. So here in the knee joint, only the femur articulates with the femur articulates only with the tibia and the patella up here, but not with the fibula. So just as the ulna missed out on one joint, here you can see the fibula is missing out on the knee, but it participates here at the ankle joint. Okay? So you should know the medial bone, the lateral bone, and, you know, the ankle joint is formed with one bone of the tarsal bone, which is called the talus. Now, in the fibula and the tibia, also what I want you to know, in the radius and ulna, remember you have these little projections which we call styloid process. In the tibia and fibula, instead of calling them styloid, we have the word malleolus. So the name changes. So malleolus is very similar to styloid process, just a little bit bigger. Then you can't call it the styloid process. If you say styloid, you're talking about the radius and the ulna. If you're talking about malleolus, you're talking about the tibia and the fibula. And then in the bones of the foot, very similar to the hand, the difference being instead of 8 tarsals, we have 7 tarsals, 5 metatarsals, 14 phalanges. Again, the thumb, the big toe has 2 phalanges, everything else has 3. And 2 big bones which you should know are this bone here, the tarsal bone. This bone here is called the talus. And this bone here, the heel bone, is known as the calcaneus. And it is this talus which articulates with the tibia. So if you look at the tibia down here and the fibula down there, and in between them, this is where the talus sits. So this, all these three form the ankle joint. So, you know, the tibia and the fibula will sit, the tibia will be on this surface like this, on this side, and the fibula here going up. And so they form the ankle joint, okay?